This is Uriah Faber, the California Kid, and you're listening to Talking Brawls.
Delighted to welcome on, for the first time in a long while, he's had a busy few months. He's been over in TriStar training with the likes of Joseph Duffy, GSP, under Farasa, Habi, Noel O'Keefe, the guys over there. Paul Redzer, Redmonds. You might, if you're regularly listening to the show, you would have heard Paul butting in a few of my interviews there from Montreal last week. First of all, Paul, great to have you on. You know, it's been a busy sort of few weeks, you know, up and down with the emotions. Probably you've got quite close to Joe and the fight cancellation dropping off. But then we had Neil obviously winning. Great performance from him last Saturday night. What have the last few months been like for you, my friend?
Yeah, they've been great, really. Well, like you said, a lot of emotions in the last couple of months. So we started even with the Scotland card. We worked that far. And,
yeah.
You know, I was building up to get me first win in the UFC and that time, and everybody knows how that fight played out. And when you come off the back of something like that, you know, you're just devastated. You don't know which way is up or down, to be honest. So, and then the Dublin card was announced. I thought it'd be like a shoe-in for that.
How was that, Paul, that you weren't on that card, especially being there on Saturday night? What was the feelings? A little bit of bittersweet emotions on Saturday night?
Oh, man. I remember from last year, even when Neil was walking out, and I was like, man, I'd love to fight in that arena, like especially with that crowd, you know. I thought it just made sense for them to put me on rather than Neil, because I think Neil could fight on any card out there, if you get me. You know, they put him on Vegas. He's a crowd pleaser, you know. So I think they could have put him on a bigger card and put me on the regional fight night card 2 minutes from my house. They didn't have to do anything. I just think that way it made sense. But the call never came, so I just took a couple of weeks out. Andy said, you know, why don't you head out to TriStar? Eric O'Keefe just said, look, the door's always open if you want to come over. And I did. I just went over and just spent 4 weeks over there with the guys in the dorms and just training with the likes of Tom, Joe, and a couple of good guys from the UFC over there, you know.
Yeah, I heard you were learning the Sage Norcutt flip as well.
A few of them were they did. The clip that was on the BJPenn.com going around, one of the guys had filmed it. It was at the end of sparring, and they were all sort of in the cage just knocking about. He just makes it look so easy. He genuinely is like a cat. When he does the flip, he doesn't hit the ground hard. He doesn't, like, there's no impact with it. He just lands like a feather on the, it's amazing, you know. it's just weird because he just does this big front flip, you know. He's big, decent woman, so he's 155, so it's not like he should be hitting the ground easy, but he just hits it like a feather. That's really the way it goes. And then they were all trying to do it, and they were all slamming themselves into the floor. It was pretty funny.
Sensational stuff. What was your reaction to Neil's performance? You know, he got the 50G bonus. You were obviously in the corner with him. Was that Neil's one of his best performances of his career? It was a fantastic finish.
Yeah, I actually put a sort of post up on Facebook the day after. You know, me and Andy had we just went for coffee, you know, just mulling over things and just chatting about the night before. And you know, even the 50Gs alone, I think it's been well overdue. Neil's been doing, you know, just even the first fight with Brad Pickett, it was sort of one or two fights from the main event, so it was up there in the card. I know usually if you're on the lower end of the card, it's hard to get the bonus, but it was up there next to the co-main, and him and Brad put on a barn burner, and he didn't get it, he missed out. I think him and Chris Beale was a great fight.
Yeah.
Him and Smoker was a great fight, but the only thing with the Smoker fight was it was behind Robbie Lawler and those guys, you know, so you probably weren't getting 50 grand with those guys fighting. But yeah, he deserved it, you know.
Yeah, of course.
And as his performance went, on Saturday night, he did everything perfect, textbook, you know. He was in trouble, I think, for about 30 seconds when the guy had his back. He didn't panic, didn't do anything. He actually listened to Andy really, really well, because he was on our side of the corner, so Andy didn't have to scream for me. He was literally right on the cage where we were facing into him. Anything Andy was instructing him, he did perfect, and he ended up getting the switch, the torn out of the back mount, came up and then got the guillotine about a minute later.
That's an interesting one. What way do you guys communicate, you know, from the cage in a loud atmosphere like that, especially in Dublin? Is it just code words, you know, 1-2, whatever?
Not really. Even with that guy, John Reyes, that was in front of him, I don't think he spoke English.
Yeah.
So it didn't really matter if he spoke cold words or not, you know. So we were just shouting in instructions. But I'm usually, I won't really say anything in the corner, you know.
Yeah.
Or I'll just, whatever advice Andy has given, I'll just shout it with Andy so he can probably hear it if he's on the other side of the cage, you know. Literally, I'm just the Iceman in the cage. I'd go in, put ice on his chest, ice on his back, and get out of there. Andy's the main man in there, you know. But I think
Andy
when you're in there,
down,
from being in the cage myself, I try and block out the cheers or anything, you know. And I really do try and sort of pigeonhole it to who I'm hearing in the corner. In there you can hear your corner pretty well, you know.
And talk to me as well about Tom Breeze. You know, a lot of people have been talking about him. We spoke with Tom last week. You were there in TriStar and I was doing the interview with Tom. Tom said he was going to finish Cahill in the first round. He went out and did it. That guy is an absolute beast.
Oh, man. Like, he's been sparring pro boxers over there. Not just, like, normal pro boxers. There's a guy called Lucien Boutte over there.
Yeah.
He's fighting James DeGale in a couple of months. You know, he's southpaw. James DeGale is a southpaw, so I think Tom was sparring him, and Boutte said, like, Boutte's an ex-world champion, and he was saying, look, when you come back out of this fight, I'm going to pay you to spar me for James DeGale. His hands are obviously that good, you know. And I actually did a lot of rolling over there, like jiu-jitsu with Tom, got a lot of rounds with him. The strength that guy has is phenomenal, you know.
He looks like a 205er. It's incredible.
He walks around lean at 205, and I'm like, how the fuck can you make 170? And he was like, 2 or 3 weeks dieting. And I was like, come on. And he's like, yeah. He says, watch. So I think it was about 3 weeks out, he just literally just cleaned up. Like, he eats pretty clean anyway, but he obviously big portions. And he literally just cleaned up his diet for 3 weeks and boom, hit 170. I was like, that's amazing. Just on the fact that you're already lean at 205. The guy could make middleweight if he wanted it, you know.
I think if he's walking around it, I think it was 196 on fight day, which is pretty incredible. 26 pounds. He put back on a lot of Nando's in there, apparently.
Yeah, we took the guys out for them for something to eat. Well, we were out with them in Nando's, and the guy can put away some serious food, like, you know, serious food.
Okay, let's go back to you, Paul. Obviously, you know, you've been working over there for the last month in TriStar with you know, Faraz, Mr. O'Keefe, and Matt Miller, the wrestling coach. You know, what was the main primary focus for you going over there? What area of your skills did you really want to shore up over there?
That's not sort of the focus I went over.
Okay.
They've got a lot of UFC guys over there. So when I went over, they had Joe, Stevie, Olivia Mason, Alex Garcia. There's a couple more there in the UFC, just off the top of my head, I can't think. So it was more of a case of, you know, I've been beaten twice in the UFC. Okay, first one wasn't in ideal circumstances. But it was more, get over there, see how you get on with the guys, the UFC guys, learn from Faraz and those guys, and then just take back as much as you can, knowledge-wise, you know. And I did it. I learned some really, really nice stuff over there. I had the notepad out, taking notes and stuff like that. So it was a really enjoyable experience over there for a month, and I'm planning a trip back fairly soon then as well, you know.
Brilliant stuff. And there's, I don't know if it's an official affiliation. I think the guys are going to stop off if they fight in Europe in Team Rhino. That can only benefit the guys and the standard mixed martial arts that both camps are going to be able to share with each other.
Yeah, but like the thing with Andy is he's very open to, he doesn't pigeonhole his own gym into just being Team Rhino or just being one way of thinking. You know, he's very open-minded, and he sent me out a couple of years ago to American Top Team. He organised the whole thing, you know. Then when this opportunity came out, he says, look, go over, learn a couple of things, learn what you can, bring it back, and, you know, it'll make your game a little bit better. So with regards to that, Andy's very open-minded, and it makes life a hell of a lot easier because you're not just focused in one little area of the gym, you know. So, yeah, he was talking to Eric the other day, and like you said, if they have any fights over this neck of the woods or if they're ever in town, you know, our gym's always open.
Fantastic stuff. Where do you feel from being over there? You know, what elements of your game, what improvements have you made in that short space of time over there?
I think my stand-up has came on a little bit, you know. They recognised some flaws in my stand-up. We tried to work on over there. As you're trying to sort of learn it and put it into practice, it's tricky because you're not really drilling it, to be honest. But it third and fourth week, you know, it was coming across that my hands were a little bit better, you know. The ground game over there I found was phenomenal. Big heel hook gym, you know, everybody likes heel hooks over there, and I've learned a couple of tricks from that end of Faraz. You know, Faraz is amazing on the ground. But then, like, the sparring, the quality of sparring that I was getting over there too was amazing. So, like I said, I did a lot of rounds with Joe Duffy. I did a lot of rounds with Stevie Ray. A lot of rounds with Olivia Mason. Those are guys who went 2-3-0 in the UFC. And, you know, I'm not getting manhandled by them. I'm doing all right against those guys. I think 155 is a better suit for me. I believe Eric O'Keefe said, he said a really... sort of, he just said about my weight. I asked sort of where I fit in the UFC, what weight class would be good for me. He said, look, you're not a 145er, you're not a 155er, you're a 150er, he said. Okay. I'm in between weights. And it does make sense, you know. I'm not a big 55er, I'm small in the UFC, but to make 145, I have to cut an unhuman amount of weight. The last one, I think we had, on the last sort of 12 hours, I had to take 15 pounds of water out of me, which is about 7.5 kilos, you know. That's a full stone, whatever way you cut it. And, you know, that type of water, it comes off your brain, comes out of your kidneys, it comes out of everywhere, you know. So can I take them big shots at 145? I don't know. Does it make sense to go to 155 and be on the smaller end of the scale? I don't know, so I'm sort of caught in between. You know, I've told the UFC I can make 155 on 3 weeks' notice.
Yeah.
To make 145, I need 10 weeks' notice. So if they're stuck for 155, I'll jump in. Otherwise, you know, you have to give me a lot of notice to make 145.
Have you had? Are they okay with you going up to 155? Because it seems like you're edging to being at 155. What you said about what the damage it does to your body there, going down to 145.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, Andy's I think male Joe Silverton. In that text, like he just said, like, you know, like that, I can make 155 in 3 weeks if your guys are stuck. I need a full sort of 10 week count to make 145, and that's where it sort of left at now, you know.
Yeah, no, you're a guy. Obviously, you fought your last two bouts at 45. Predominantly, you're as you mentioned, if there was a weight class at, you know, 150, that'd be ideal. But you've had most of your career at 155. Tell me about the difference. You know, from you going into the cage at 45 and at 55, and the way it affects your performance.
All right. So first things first, I have to cut an awful lot of water at 45. Like I said, it comes off the brain, and everywhere, you know. So that whole week, I'm making 145. My kidneys, my back is actually haunting me. You know, it's a weird one. Throughout the whole 10-week camp, if I'm making 45, I have to be 100% strict on calorie restriction. It's your body's not supposed to be calorie restricted when it's training that hard. It's supposed to, like, you're supposed to be able to eat anything. I know I eat fairly clean, you know, regardless. But to make a 155, it just takes me 3 weeks. It's not that big of a struggle. I think I'm strong at 155. Anybody I've talked to thinks I'm better at 155. But then you look at some of the guys in the UFC and they're 6 foot at 145. But what I've said was before, I think body shapes make weight classes, if you get me. I mean, there's some guys in there at 45, they're 6 foot with really narrow waist and lean, and they walk around about 75 kilos. I've got a really big wide waist. I'm sort of straight all the way down, and I walk around about 81 kilos. It's weird, if you get me, you know. And the guys in at 145 are massive, and the guys in 155 are massive. And then there's me. I'm not big on either end of the scale, you know. So I'm just caught in the middle. I'm a 150er.
And Paul, have you been guaranteed another fight from UFC brass?
No, I haven't heard anything from them, you know. So I'm sort of in limbo. Everybody keeps thinking of, I know where I stand, or I have a fight here, a fight there. You know, I know as much as the next guy.
Okay, and let's look at that. Right, there is, we're presuming you're still with the UFC, as far as you know. You are, there's a lot of fight cards coming up. As you said, you'd have 3 weeks to make 55. There's cards coming up in Boston, Vegas, London. What would be ideal for you to get back in the octagon? What sort of time frame?
Like I said, I can do it in 3 weeks and I'll be fully fit. I've been training hard. I'm always really fit. I don't really get too out of shape, you know. It's just really to make 45, it's just that weight issue, yeah. You know. But a nice time frame would be 6 weeks, be perfect for 155, you know. Or even 5 weeks, you know, be perfect for 155. I know then there's three shows back to back, December 10, 11, yeah. And 12. I think there's a couple of 55ers on them, you know. There's got to be a pull out somewhere, you know. But then you don't want to be started basing your career on other people's injuries then as well, you know. You don't want to be jumping in at the back of somebody else's misfortune. So, you know, let's see where we go. In my own head, I thought Dublin. And then I'm thinking they might put me on the February London card. It just makes sense, you know. So, let's see how it goes.
Is there extra pressure? You know, surely there is going into your next fight with all the roster cuts has been lately. I think the UFC are going to make 60 more. Have you been thinking about that?
I mean, like, there's always pressure, to be honest. You know, going into my last fight, I would have been cut straight after if I had a loss. You don't want to be thinking like that either, you know. Oh, I'm fighting for my fucking job here and stuff like that. But yeah, that's the realization of, you know, nobody really goes 0-3 in the UFC and sticks about to tell the tale, to be honest. So, but look, it's not like I'm going to go out and start to try and jab me way to victory, or I'm trying to fucking make a horrible fight just to win. I'm going to go out and do what I always fucking do and just swing for the fences and
put on an entertaining show.
Put on a good show. You know, nobody wants to see a shit fight. Nobody wants to see fucking nothing happening in a fight and booing you and going for a drink while you're fighting. I'm not that type of fighter, you know, just to save my job in the UFC. I'm going to go out. They want to see people go out and try and put on a show. I'm going to try and go out and put on a show in my next fight. So
Paul, a major question we have to ask you is, did you see any rewards from Neil Series bonus on Saturday night? Did he even get you a point?
Did I? Fuck. no, do you know, like, he deserves every penny of that.
Definitely.
As I said, he's been overdue one of them, like, more than once. So, he's best of luck to him with it, you know.
Just reaction, just one last final question for you. Reaction to the crowd on Saturday night, another really solid effort from the crowd, you know. Even though the card was, you know, a few fights fell out and stuff.
Even though the cards fell out, even though the two co-main men fell out, I take the crowd out just on fights alone. I think the fights were brilliant.
Yeah, they were.
I think it was actually a good card just based on fights. I mean, you look at, you'd got Neil's fight, Ashland's fight, Louis and Paddy's fight. You'd got Darren Till, Dalby. They were.
Yeah, unbelievable.
That was great for you, you know. So I think on the whole, the card was a solid card. Would have been nice if the co-main and main was in there, but look, like I said, the Irish are pissheads and they'll go out and they'll scream for anybody, and which they did. They weren't just screaming for the hometown fighters, they were making noise throughout the whole card, you know. And I think Dana put it up, he says, if you're a fight fan, or that's where you want to be fighting, you know, Ireland.
Definitely. Paul Redmond, I think this is the first what is it, Skype interview segment to the podcast we're doing. We're going to put these up on YouTube from now on. So, great to catch up with you again, Paul. Where can the guys find you on Twitter?
Redzer MMA, Facebook, just like me bleeding, like page, Paul Redzer Redmond. I don't know. I barely look at any of that, to be honest, but Twitter, Redzer MMA.
Great to have you on, Paul. Always do appreciate the time. I can't wait for you to get back in the octagon. Very much looking forward to it.
Thanks for the bell, Noel.